On the campus of Kansas State University in Manhattan, the K-State Radio Network now presents an address by U.S. Army Chief of Staff General William Westmoreland. General Westmoreland is this year's third speaker in the series of Landon Lectures on public issues. And his appearance here this afternoon is his first before a university audience since his return from duty in Southeast Asia last year. General Westmoreland is a 1936 graduate of West Point. He advanced rapidly through the ranks to become, in 1956, the youngest major general in the Army at that time. He became a full general in August of 1964 when he assumed command of the American forces in Vietnam. During World War II, he served in Tunisia, Sicily, France, Belgium, and Germany. He later served in Korea from 1960 to 63, was superintendent of the Military Academy at West Point. President Johnson named him Army Chief of Staff in July of last year. Now for the formal introductions, we switch to the platform and Kansas State University President, Dr. James A. McCain.
We are honored to have as a special guest another alumnus of Kansas State University, a fine gentleman who just a few months ago was serving as the senior United States Senator from our state and who at that time joined with me in inviting our lecturer to come to the campus on this occasion. And I refer, of course, to a great friend of our university and a great statesman, former United States Senator Frank Carlson. One of the close neighbors to our campus, of course, is Fort Riley, and the relationships between our university and our downtown community and the fort have always been most constructive and cordial, and it's especially a pleasure, therefore, for us to have as a guest of honor on the campus, Commanding General from Fort Riley, General Linton Boatwright, General Boatwright. I would like to introduce the chairman of the Student Faculty Convocations Committee, which makes the arrangements for programs of this type. Certainly he has been most effective in this capacity, Dr. William Boyer, head of the Department of Political Science. And of course, Kansas State University's favorite adopted son, our most distinguished professor, and the outstanding citizen of our state whom we honor through this lecture series, Governor Alf Landon, I introduce to you at this time. Our governor, the Honorable Robert Docking, was asked by the then President of the United States, Lyndon Johnson, to travel as his special representative to Vietnam 2 years ago. While he was in Vietnam, our distinguished lecturer was his host, and the two became fast friends and have seen each other often since that first occasion to get acquainted with one another. We thought it would be singularly appropriate if we invited Governor Bob Docking to introduce our lecturer at today's convocation. It's my pleasure, therefore, to introduce to you at this time the first citizen of our state and certainly a warm and cordial friend of Kansas State University, Governor Bob Docking.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, President McCain, students, faculty, and friends. In August of 1967, I was in Vietnam, and while the temperature reached at times over 120 degrees, I was escorted through every section of the country, from Can Tho in the south to Da Nang in the north. I traveled by military jet, by helicopter, small aircraft, jeep, and sampan. I walked through the small hamlets around Pleiku, through rice paddies in the Delta, in knee-deep mud near Rakhine, to see and to talk with Americans and Vietnamese who live each day with the war in Vietnam. My experiences in the fields and in the hamlets of Vietnam helped me to understand and also to appreciate the great responsibility shouldered by General Westmoreland, who for 4 years held one of the toughest military commands in the world today, and that was the command of the United States forces in Vietnam. When I met General Westmoreland, my first reaction was to expect a hardened, tough soldier, tense from the strain of one of the most difficult commands in military history. I did meet a man who is not only a great soldier, but who is also commanding and soft-spoken, with a sense of humor, and with a compassionate concern for his men and for the people that he was defending. Since our first meeting nearly 2 years ago, we have had the opportunity to visit other times in different parts of our country. I have found him a most remarkable man, whose opinion I value and range of knowledge and ideals and of dedication I deeply respect. General Westmoreland was graduated from West Point as Captain of Cadets in 1936. In World War II, he commanded artillery in Africa and in Europe. He was promoted to full colonel at the age of 30. And during the Korean conflict, he commanded the 187th Airborne Regiment and won the rank of Brigadier General at the young age of only 38. He then became Secretary to the General Staff, Commander of the elite 101st Airborne Division, the Superintendent of the United States Military Academy at West Point, New York, Commander of the United States Forces in Vietnam, and now Chief of Staff of the United States Army. There are two true stories told about General Westmoreland, which I believe best portray the man. While commanding the 101st Division, General Westmoreland visited a rugged ranger training school. He was watching the men swing across the river on a rope. Though he was a major general, General Westmoreland decided to try it himself. He did, but fell into the water. He climbed out of the water dripping wet, and he tried it again. He fell into the river a second time, only to come out and try it again. In 1958, unexpected high winds caused the tragic deaths of five paratroopers of the 101st Division in a mass practice jump over Fort Campbell, Kentucky. General Westmoreland has been a commander who has literally never asked his men to do anything he would not do himself. During practice jumps after the tragedy, General Westmoreland jumped ahead of his men in order to test wind conditions. General Westmoreland has been described as a commander's commander, a man who has the habit of command. In the service of his nation, he has exercised that power in the best traditions of our nation. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure, as well as great honor, to welcome to the state of Kansas and to the Kansas State University campus, General William Westmoreland.
Dawkins, President McCain, Governor Landon, Senator Carlson, distinguished gentlemen on the platform, members of the faculty, students at Kansas State University, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed my pleasure to be invited to address this group, although I believe that it's a dubious honor to be the one to welcome you back from spring vacation. Your response from my introduction by the governor of your great state tempts me to entitle my talk,
faith, hope, and charity. By your reception, you have shown an act of faith. If you see fit to hear me out, it will be an act of hope. And finally, if you choose to acknowledge my presentation, it will indeed be an act of charity. We hear much these days about the generation gap. Like most things, I suspect this is part fiction and part fact. On the other hand, following a recent personal experience with my youngest child, I am inclined to believe that it's mostly fact. Several days ago, I was driving my own car to the center of Washington with my 13-year-old daughter at my side. When we passed the Washington Monument, I commented to her that when I was a little boy, approximately her age, my father took me on a trip to Washington, and I climbed the stairway of the Washington Monument all the way to the top, which I considered quite a feat. My young daughter was unimpressed. She saw things in an entirely different perspective. She commented, "Daddy, I'm surprised. I didn't know that Washington's monument was that old." Seemingly, I stand at this moment in two worlds. As a member of the military, I stand in the world of the establishment. And as lecturer at your great university, I stand in the world of the educator, overlapping the world of the student. Supposedly, between our two worlds, there's a great distance, not just from this podium to the front row, but the gigantic chasm and abyss called the generation gap. This alleged gap is particularly wide, since from what I hear, it begins at age 30, and I must confess that I more than qualify in this regard. In any event, without falling into this chasm, I hope to bridge that alleged gap today, even for a moment. If even with a thread of understanding concerning your United States Army. In my judgment, through knowledge and understanding, the military establishment and of its role that it plays in our society are matters of importance to all informed citizens. In this regard, the higher portion of American citizens who make a real effort to be informed, the better the likelihood that the citizenry will endorse through our democratic process basic decisions affecting our national welfare, national security, as well as in other areas. It is not the task of the professional military to lead in this informing process. We in uniform should not, must not become public advocates for particular courses of action. We must meticulously avoid actions which challenge the doctrine of civilian supremacy or which smacks of service partisanship. Still, as citizens, the military should not remain silent. It is difficult to associate silence with the kind of educative dialogue required by our country. And professional military men must be appreciative of their role in our society when they speak. On the other hand, it seems to me that our citizenry, specifically those of you who are being educated for future leadership, must also be aware of the function of the military and the limits of these functions. Definitive formulations of roles are hard to come by in this area. Once again, you share with me a continuing concern as citizens for problems which are infinitely easier to state than they are to solve. Consequently, in talking about the Army, I shall go back to the beginnings to discuss its foundation, and then its necessity to have interface with our society. I will discuss its role as a part of the military establishment, fundamental characteristics of the Army, wellsprings, or sources of capability, and finally I will comment on specific Army capabilities, what it can do and what it cannot do. The foundation of our present military establishment was laid in the cornerstone of our government the Constitution of the United States. Our founding followers and fathers had a great fear of a large permanent military. They had inherited from Europe a distrust of the military, which had for years been the bulwark of the personal armies of kings. They were terrified at the legislative army of Cromwell. Because of this inheritance, our founding fathers feared for the liberties of the people. The framers of our Constitution correctly took care of watching the army. They incorporated into the Constitution certain provisions which for over 190 years have successfully regulated and directed our military, a situation which I might add is unique in the world. And then the new government received through the Constitution sufficient authority to develop a military establishment, an establishment as large as needed for the defense of our nation, and one which could be supported by our national resources. The size of this establishment in a representative government depends on the current mood of the public. Our Constitution states, and I quote, that the Congress shall have power to raise and support armies, but no appropriation of money to that use shall be for longer than 2 years. To provide and maintain a navy, and to provide for calling forth the militia to execute the laws of the Union, suppress insurrection, and repel invasions. Several concepts are immediately apparent in these constitutional provisions. First, notice the contrast between the phrases raise and support armies and provide and maintain a navy. It is clear that the founders and framers of our Constitution wanted a citizen army that could be raised in time of emergency. Their desire was the basis of our civilian soldier concept that was intended to continue. On the other hand, to provide and maintain a navy conceived of a force in being. Such a concept is quite consistent with the maritime nature of our original states. And our founders were well aware of the tremendous time lag between developing and producing capital ships. They reasoned that without such a force in being, no naval threat could be engaged. However, over the years, technology has virtually eliminated the former luxury of time and distance. The threat to our national security has increased at the same time. Technology has rapidly advanced in all services. Weaponry has become increasingly sophisticated. Consequently, the need of an army in being has become an essential factor to our national security. Going back to the Constitution, we see in its provisions concerning the militia the need to draw on the civilian in times of emergency. Conditions have not altered this need. And in order to regulate and control the Navy, the Constitution implied control through the use of its purse strings. However, to temper the new government's fear of powerful standing armies, the unique 2-year appropriation rider was attached to the acts of raising armies. In order to further the system of checks and balances, the Constitution vested military command in the executive branch with the President as Commander-in-Chief of the Services and of the Militia when activated. Authority over the military was further fragmented by giving states control of their own militias. Thus, they became another effective check against a large standing federal army, and as a byproduct precluded America from ever using a legislative army of the Congress or a personal army of the President. So we see that from the very beginning, our Constitution affirmed the American historic concept of a dual military system under civilian control. The dual system is visible today in our one army of the people made up of regulars, reserves, National Guard, selectees, all being interdependent. But being supervised by the people through the Congress, the President, and the states. Throughout the years, our Army has kept pace with a dynamic American society, but always under civilian control. Our armed forces are the staunchest supporters of our form of government. They themselves would resist all efforts to change that basic policy. The Army is profoundly aware that it exists for the American people and operates under the command and control of dedicated civilians who owe their position and authority to the constitutional process. Therefore, the Army can accomplish for an extended period only those missions which are accepted by the American nation, which the Army exists to support. Composed of a representative segment of the American people, the Army must believe as an institution that what it is doing is right, proper, and directed by the people. Further, as I stressed earlier, the Army is acutely conscious that it is not and cannot become a political force within the United States. Each individual certainly may, as a citizen, and should responsibly consider national issues and exercise his mandate to vote. But as an institution, the Army must not attempt to influence domestic political processes. For this reason, the Army is reluctant to engage in domestic tasks which involve domestic politics. However, it does have a role in civil works, disaster relief, and civil emergencies. As an agency within the executive branch, the Army is only one of many institutions of policy. The Army blends its military capabilities into an integrated whole, involving all the instruments of national policy, political, economic, diplomatic, and psychological, all a part of a well-orchestrated national effort. The Army must not only be prepared and flexible to meet new and unforeseen requirements to support national programs, it must also be prepared to do so effectively within the bounds of our national style. Traditionally, the American people have cherished the concept of the citizen soldier. Deeply embedded within the American ethos is the idea that every citizen is a soldier. Our Army and our country have grown and developed on the precept of civilian and military teamwork. Above all, we seek to maintain a balance between the citizen soldier and the professional soldier. To stay healthy, the military establishment is dependent on American citizenry. I'm talking, of course, about the continuous movement of citizens in and out of the service, the movement which maintains the needed civilian contact and citizen contact, and awareness between our military establishment and our citizenry, and without which the Army might become a danger to our society, a danger which our forefathers so carefully tried to preclude. Let me talk for a moment about the dependence of the military on the people. In an effort to remain apolitical, let me acknowledge my awareness of the selective service issue. This is a deep philosophical problem. If all are not to serve, who should serve? What are the economic and social implications of an all-volunteer force? As you know, President Nixon has recently appointed an advisory commission composed of leading citizens to study this matter in depth. I have purposely not gone into specifics on the selective service system, commonly called the draft. But I do want to make a point in passing. Contrary to what many people think, the Army has nothing to do with running the draft. The draft is run by an entirely separate agency of our government, over which neither the Army nor the Department of Defense has any control. Having set the record straight on this one, I shall continue. Perhaps one of the distinguishing characteristics of our century is the movement of all professions toward the concept of specialization. Yet I believe that recently we have witnessed in our society a gradual reversal toward generalization. Certainly as never before in our history, our nation has need for well-rounded thinkers, spherical thinkers, as I prefer to call them, not men with a single vision. Rather, we need enlightened men who can relate, men who can see the mutual dependence or non-dependence of matters, and yet at the same time, men who can view the several parts as a whole. Although the military profession has had its share of specialization, it has only been an extracurricular activity. A brief look at the educational credentials of the officer corps of the Army shows both their quality and their broad basis. For example, nearly 90% of the career officers in the Army today hold baccalaureate degrees. Our goal, of course, is 100%. Also, through the Army's civilian schooling program, especially selected officers are trained at leading universities in order to meet specific needs, which demand the higher disciplines associated with master's degrees and doctorates. Today, some 20% of our career officers already hold advanced degrees, and we estimate that approximately 75% of our career officers may expect the opportunity to gain advanced degrees during their service. As an example, this morning I spoke to over 1,400 officers at the Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Approximately 30% of the American officers in the audience today had advanced degrees, either master's or doctorates. And incidentally, within the audience, there were 97 foreign officers representing 51 countries of the earth. The day when wars were fought by military tactics alone have long since passed, if indeed this situation ever existed. Rather, the waging of war and the maintenance of peace and security are products of national efforts, which include all instruments of national policy: the political, the socioeconomic, the psychological, and the military. Obviously, current demands have added new dimensions to the challenges faced by military commanders. As never before, the military is in need of generals, not specialists. Officers who are military men first and foremost, but who have an awareness and appreciation of the other factors that inevitably have a bearing on national policy. Vietnam is undoubtedly the best example of our need for this type of leader. Five wars are being waged in Vietnam today, one at one and the same time. It is unrealistic to speak of them separately because they're so closely meshed and mutually supported. And yet for analysis, it is often necessary to view each individually to discover its complexities and its interrelationship with the others. I shall cite these wars briefly. First, the war in Vietnam is fundamentally political. Needless to say, such is the case in all war. Second, the war in Vietnam is sociological. Third, the war is economic. Fourth, the war is psychological. The existence of these four separate but related wars tends to be obscured by the tempo of the fifth, the military war. Violence is more easily depicted and more readily perceived than are the rather undramatic but vital actions of nation building. This so-called war of national liberation, being less than total, and I'm referring to total war in the sense of World War I and World War II, is often more complex, often more demanding. And thus we need more than ever before military leaders who are spherical thinkers, not men with stovepipe vision. We need the man who finds exhilaration in the study of all aspects of mankind. Man's capacity to love and hate, his willingness to serve and desire to govern, his thirst for truth, and the man who is just and compassionate, the man who is a humanist. We need the leader who looks out for his men, who knows his position as a servant of the people, who has wisdom to see beyond his present actions to what their consequences might be. There is only one place that this type of man can originate. He must be the product of a liberal education. He must come from our institutions of higher learning, the fountainheads of humanism. Surely the late General Eisenhower, who came from this heart of America, was one of these men. All of us, you and I, wish within our hearts that armies could be forever eliminated from the face of the earth. Only a fool would ever hope for war. One who has tested the bitterness and witnessed the cruelties of war certainly would never become its advocate. Yet, while we work to achieve peace, to see that day when armies are eliminated from the face of the earth, we must continue to face the harsh realities of life. And violence between men and violence between nations are harsh realities with which we must be able to cope. I have talked about the foundations of the military establishment as they relate to the army, with which we must be able to cope. I have talked about the foundations of the military establishment as they relate to the army. I have discussed the citizen-soldier concept, and I have touched upon the army's leadership needs as they both pertain to the armies reflecting the will of our society. With the foregoing as background and as food for thought, I should further like to reinforce some of the points I have attempted to make. I have organized these additional thoughts to discuss in turn the role of the Army within the military establishment, fundamental characteristics of the Army, wellsprings or sources of capability, and lastly, several remarks on specific capability. In addition to the checks and balances established by the Constitution, your Army operates within very precise guidelines that establish its statutory responsibilities to the nation. The military establishment as a whole is directed, and I quote, to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, to ensure by timely and effective military action the security of the United States, its possessions, and areas vital to its interests, to uphold and enhance the national policies and interests of the United States, and to safeguard the internal security of the United States, end of quote. In short, the military establishment is tasked to defend and secure the nation, its citizens, and its interests. The primary role of the Army is its responsibility for the preparation of land forces necessary for the effective defense of the nation. In carrying out its role, the Army is able to physically seize and occupy the land, thereby asserting prolonged influence on the will of man who is a land being. And in influencing man, the Army is capable of applying force selectively and in measured fashion. It may be force represented by the power to influence action through assistance or advisory relationships, or force as represented by the restrained use of conventional land power, as in Vietnam, or force implied in the possession of nuclear weapons. And the most important characteristic of the Army is its dependence on man. Because the Army relies on man and not machine, and because it is composed of men from every field of endeavor, it is capable of unique flexibility the flexibility which permits the Army to adapt to any mission it may be assigned. Many times in history, your Army has demonstrated its flexibility in meeting the needs of our nation, needs which emphasize construction rather than destruction. The need to map and survey our new and growing nation caused our young republic to send its small army west of the Appalachians. A need for engineering talent to develop our nation led to creation of the first fire engineering school established in the United States, the United States Military Academy, founded in 1802. Incidentally, the military academy has kept up with the increasing complexity of modern defense. As a result, West Point now has a broad curriculum balanced between the sciences and the humanities. In its four-year academic program, a cadet completes 19 courses in the mathematics, science, engineering field, 21 courses in the social science humanities field, and 8 elective courses which he may choose to pursue in either field or in a combination of both fields. Need for increased wider range of communication in the developing nation calls on engineering to plan and control railroads and canals to include the Panama Canal and the Lower Canal. Needs of health give the West Leon and Medical School to conquer type one and double fever, to develop the needs of water purification, with chlorination, to develop blood collection, blood plasma sources. And this will lead the West to develop when slightly up through terrorists and hurting while they're running the West. Needs of the nature of the way they're dirt to first and the way to interior, where it makes less of our wind blow more than the two species of land on conservation control. They must be left with a social welfare, which will get the resources of the present office of the economic opportunity, and this record will be the drought for. Needs for reflection space, where the Army to level out of its full level, the only way to survive, with which the challenge was forming, would be the left. The major charge being elected by the Army experts in 1963-62 to Mount Wallace and the Barrett, frozen tunnel. And lead them redirection where they tell us when it will end well, and in Vietnam. The Army never was in the pioneer, but only there in building roads, riding textbooks, and showing bridges and roads. But also, there's led many to our land, towards the Westwood men. The Army has many men and women who would never be able to serve the armed forces because of the lack of education. It is one man who has given special training in which enables the regular combat to soldiers. It is very important because of an opportunity to the risk of and develop attitudes of habit, which makes me more fearless and sensitive. Thus, the Army is the individual of the nation to the best of his soul. The interest of the Army is the real advantage when the youth of the latter takes off their uniform. There is political correction with 12 contributions, who dispense the regular battle to the district to prepare themselves and close to the uniform. With several months prior to completing their Army service, soldiers to oversee these functions for any to prepare them and the rest of the civilian laws in government and industry. Training means which improves their future potential and examines a strength to our nation. The Army led this nation in creating a truly integrated society where the race for the go forward. And in the American can grasp their callings with its demonstrated capability. Through the military service, our youth have learned how to live and work together as a military. Men who never leave the world is crazy fellow working with men required to be so out. The misservices of their country. The very day the girls to undo is directing the federal field all out of our life for the men. I won't tell you, I'll live to see another dawn until the great road was all again. Through himself upon an exploding region later. And a product of soldier is counsel and led it through out of our Catholic chaplain. Give me your treasure. It will throw up this twisting our nation by overcoming the local image and then misunderstandings associated with social change taking place within
our wishes to love will ever bless the fellow in Landon Lecture. And by the plan, the grapple will always be already equally interested in the peace well of Lecture's role and world. It is so powder possible with his reckless red clever that it does. It is so powder possible with his reckless red clever that it is so much more letter than all his reticent vocals. We continue to trellery of our nation. I should say many other contributions for us besides to the difficult peace rather than around. However, let me make it perfectly clear that I'm not attempting to paint a picture of sweetness and life. The other lady is equally capable of performing this victory of providing security to our nation through its complete mastery of the art of warfare. We have seen that the army never reflects the possibility of these and without the quality of any American person. The only capability that derives or come from what Larry shall call the wellsprings of capability. Wellsprings which are continuously destroyed by the constant relationship between our army and our society. The most important wellspring, of course, the capability of the army as a profession, the nature of the first well nation. And an awareness of false. The primary wellspring of capability is the nature of the army, and we are the one with services as a profession. It is a unique profession, or the man's ultimate commitment, service that must accelerate to the point of death. The professional military man must bear the awesome responsibility, not only for his own life, but also for those who serve under his command. For the level of lust takes the oath of office, he swears that he will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, with all up in the minimal resolution. Through this oath, the responsibility of the military profession goes to the UN itself, and goes under one's direct command. It extends to the survival of our nation. With total commitment and total responsibility comes the total dedication to country which characterizes the American soldier. As the army places this unique demand upon a man, it also develops unique perspectives within the individual, perspectives which also contribute to the wellspring of army capability. The soldier must believe in what he is doing, is contributing in the surrender to the resolution of what really matters or to our citizens. That is, he must be assured that he is working in the best interest of the country. In the later days, this direct association was relatively easy to establish. The Indian fighter saw and knew the settlers will meet precursors. Today, it tends to be more difficult to establish such a relationship due to our global commitments and our large and far more complex society. However, it has been my experience that this relationship has been successfully bridged by these young men and women who have continued to step forward when their country needed them. Another contributor to the world's great capability is also derived from the professional nature of the enemy. It is what I term the search for adequacy. In this prevalent war, one can never completely be certain of his enemy's capability, much less his intensity. If the professional military leader continues by his oath to be responsible for American lives and the security of the nation, he must strive to develop the capabilities in being which will deter that, or which at least will defend in the interest of the United States at the lowest possible cost in life. Contrary to some voices, this leader is not a grasping megalomaniac. nor is he part of the level of so-called military industrial complex. The complex which allegedly generates ever-increasing military requirements and in turn military capability. The considered judgment, a judgment of dedicated, experienced professionals with one goal in mind, a nation's survival against the threats of an uncertain tomorrow. Many will argue that the military wants too much, that it neglects its requirements, and deprecates its capabilities to grow larger at the expense of other national needs. This debate is good. It is healthy. It is the unique product of our open and free society. The Army force is only one of many in the great defense debate. All voices must be heard. But one important fact stands out in the foremost of our society. It is the responsibility of the people to establish the final priority. The second level of capability is the nature of the threat. It is the standard which your army determines its requirements and measures its capability. The threat is complex. It is bipolar at the strategic nuclear level and multipolar in its potential for conducting conventional warfare. In addition, there are literally tens of nations capable of supporting aggressive insurgency within the borders of their neighbors. The threat is further complicated by a spectrum of weaponry which extends from the highly sophisticated weapons possessed by the Soviet Union to sharpened stakes and crossbows which have been employed in undeveloped countries. Areas of possible commitment range from tropical jungle to arid desert to frigid Arctic. Each of these extreme environments requires its own adaptations and army capabilities and techniques of employment. Never before in the history of war has the military force of our nation faced such a diverse challenge. Today, it is conceivable that a combat unit could be required to move from the jungles of Vietnam to the mountainous southern Germany in a matter of days. Overnight, the unit will address changes drastically from the jungle ambush to mass Soviet tanks operating in an advanced tactical environment with the ever-present threat of the enemy's use of nuclear weapons. The range of problems facing the United States Army is unique. For example, our Army must be prepared to act equally effectively against threats to the safety of United States citizens abroad, against acts of deliberate aggression under the guise of insurgency, and against overt attack accompanied by nuclear assault. No other army faces a wider range of challenges. The third and last wellspring which I wish to discuss is national policy, an omnibus term which I use to describe the range of decisions made at higher national levels which delineate the Army's capabilities. National policy in this sense would include decisions such as the basic national military strategy which a nation shall pursue
and the resources in terms of men, material, and money, which are to be allocated to the Army to meet that strategy. The Army is offered full and adequate opportunity to have its views considered, but the decision very properly rests with civilian national leadership. There are other less obvious factors which influence Army capability. Here I am thinking of such aspects as the rate of technological advance in our society, which poses problems in developing and producing weapons. If we delay purchase of a new weapon, we may be able to buy a new, radically better weapon later on. But if we wait too long, we find ourselves facing an enemy fully armed with weapons better than ours. Decisions regarding research and development are difficult, but they at least imply freedom to influence the future. The weapons the Army possesses today reflect procurement decisions made 5 to 10 years ago. As in all worldly affairs, you pay your money and you take your choice. All things in life have costs, and as resources devoted to national defense are reduced, so also is the level of defense readiness reduced. The Army is most certainly not a slave to the past, a slave unable to react to the present, a slave unable to prepare for the future. Its capabilities are directed by decisions which lie beyond its power, in authority or in time. This is the third wellspring of capability. Up to this point, my remarks have purposely been general in nature and perhaps a bit theoretical. Hopefully, I've set the stage for several specific thoughts which I would like to leave with you. Naturally, the degree of proficiency with which the Army can fulfill any particular capability is, of course, dependent on the wellsprings which I've discussed in terms of men, material, money provided to the Army. However, at almost any reasonable level of resource allocation, the Army has certain capabilities, but at the same time, there are capabilities which the Army cannot possess, regardless of its level of resources, capabilities which money cannot buy. Let us take a look at what the Army can do and also what it cannot do. For example, the Army can conduct offensive operations to attain specific objectives, but it cannot ensure the desirability, viability, or reliability of the political situation which results. The Army can help win a war, but every element of government in the nation must help to win the peace. The Army can provide forces designed to defend in Europe or Asia in order to represent the national will to defend, but it cannot constitute the national will. While our Army should be and is a mirror of the society which it represents, the possession of capability alone does not deter aggression. There must be the will to deploy in order to deter. The will must come from the nation, not from the Army. The Army can prevent a guerrilla army from achieving its military objectives, but it cannot resolve the political problems from which an insurgency is derived. Successful elimination of the sources of insurgency involves far more than a military effort. It requires a coordinated national effort in support of an allied nation willing to institute political, military, and economic change. The Army can equip, train, and advise a foreign army, but it cannot ensure that the Army will be used to advance representative government or economic development. In increasing the military capabilities of a foreign army, we are not guaranteed that the Army will be used the way we would wish it, nor does it ensure the favorable solution of internal political and economic problems. The Army can be employed to alleviate the symptoms of domestic discontent, but it cannot remove the sources of discontent. The Army can, within carefully prescribed limits, contribute its expertise to the resolution of grievances, but it cannot do this to the detriment of its primary mission of providing security against foreign threats. I have described the upper and lower limits of capability, in each case extreme examples. Current and probable Army capabilities generally fall between the two. Precisely where they fall can only be determined by decisions made by the executive branch, by the Congress, and ultimately by the electorate. We're now at a point in history where we are conducting a major review of our commitments and policy. That review naturally requires that numerous questions be asked and answered. If the informed citizen is to properly evaluate proposals, he must be aware of these questions. Is the most significant threat to the United States foreign or domestic, or is it a combination of the two? To what extent can we safely rely on the support of overseas allies to ensure our national security? Is their degree of support commensurate with our degree of reliance? Who are our enemies? What are their intentions? Do we base our actions on what they are capable of doing, or do we base our actions on our assessment of the enemy's intentions? Ladies and gentlemen, today in seeking to bridge the so-called generation gap, I have stressed the continuous need for interface between American citizens and her army. I have stressed the Army's role in our society, and particularly as an element provided by the Constitution with safeguards as to its use. It is an element which, as a social force, has spearheaded integration, improved education, and trained thousands for leadership. It is an element which, in conjunction with other services, provides security for our nation. It is an element which is always ready to respond to constituted civilian authority in support of our nation's commitment. It is an element which does not make policy, but it is an instrument of that policy. It is a shield behind which our democratic processes have thrived and behind which our nation has developed. In talking to you, I have addressed my remarks recognizing fully your dual status, both as students concerned with the present and as students faced with the awesome responsibility for leadership of our future society. Accordingly, I ask that in each role, you understand the constitutional basis for the foundation and utilization of the armed forces of our nation. And finally, that you recognize that these forces are essential elements in the society of which you will soon become an active and most certainly a constructive participant. Dr. McCain, Governor Landon, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for the opportunity to address this fine body of citizens, and I welcome you back from your Easter vacation.